Good evening, students. Are you ready?
Yes.
We want to continue our discussion in physics. Yesterday we have seen what is the one-dimensional motion. This is a straight line motion in here, straight line. And we have seen the graphical representation. All the graphical representation with the displacement and the time graph. And also velocity time graph. Isn't it? Everything we have is also V. So this is the thing we have to understand now. What is the distance as area under the velocity time graph? So we are able to find out the value of the distance traveled by the body in terms of area. That is actually question asked in the NEET examination. In which way the distance can be measured by area, that is a physics, that modification can be obtained by plotting a curve. So suppose your body starts with the initial time t1 and the final time t2. Within this time interval, what is the distance traveled by the body? This distance traveled by the body can be calculated by way of graph, in which you have to find out, first you have to find out a curve drawn between, already we know the velocity time graph. So suppose the body moves from the position, this is called A, let it be A, B, A. This is the time at T1, this is the time graph T1. This is T2. Within this distance, this area under shaded portion, kindly make note of the area, then we can easily find out V curve. We already discussed about the velocity time graph. The point, this is T1, this point is T. This point is T2. So this is a curve A to D. So join all the thing, take a shaded portion. What is the area of the shaded portion? That is ABCD. If the area ABCD directly gives the distance traveled by the body, because we know velocity is equal to distance by time. We already know velocity is equal to distance by time, therefore distance equal to velocity into time. Therefore, this velocity time graph will give distance. The velocity multiplied by a time. So, this graph directly gives the value of distance by drawing or by plotting between the two time intervals, whatever may be the time intervals. So, you have to take the curve, this is an origin, let it be. So, 1 second, 2 second, or 1 minute, 3 minute, whatever may be the thing. Between the time interval for 5 minutes, so this is a 5, this is 15 minutes, that is a 15. Then plot the time, what is its velocity at the regular interval, all the velocity and the time graph with a star value and the line joining of all the thing will give the curve AD. So from this, the shaded portion of the curve directly gives the area, that the area directly gives the value of displacement. So we are having condition how the velocity become displacement. We know the formula, displacement is equal to change in position of the body, whereas velocity is equal to rate of change in position of the body. Therefore, displacement by time will give velocity, from which displacement can be calculated within the stipulated graph. Okay, this is the thing we have to understand. The next is very, very important. This vertical motion under gravity. I already told you that in the heading itself. You are saying that it is a straight line motion. How it is possible, sir? If the body moves positive direction as well as a negative direction, we already having the example. So this is a origin. Suppose the body moves a distance x1. After that it comes to x2. What is the displacement of the body? This is called positive x. This is the negative x. Therefore, both it is positive and negative direction. This is a straight line motion. Like that, if the body moves upward, as well as the downward direction, this is also straight line motion. Not only horizontal, but also vertical. We are having up and down. The upward direction as well as the downward direction. What is the thing you have to understand? Easily, we know the four equations of motion. That is, V is equal to U plus AT. S is equal to UT plus half AT square. V square is equal to U square plus 2AS. This is the three important equation we discussed yesterday. So, kindly make note of this. So, suppose if the body thrown up, the body thrown upward direction. Upward direction means the body moves against the gravity. Am I correct? The gravity, acceleration due to gravity, always acting towards the earth with a value of G. Any body actually towards the earth. So, if the body thrown up, that is a thing you have to understand it. The body, take a chalk piece in your hand. The chalk piece cannot go up as it is. Some priest are preaching us in which way we can move upward direction. If you use certain mantra or certain yoga, you can lift from your body from the earth. Is it possible physically? Kindly discuss yourself. Is it possible according to physics? Can any body can move upward by itself? Definitely it is not possible. Why? Because all the body are attracted downwards due to gravity. If we want to move up, we have to give force against the acceleration due to gravity. Then only we can fly or we can move upward direction. Somebody is cheating us. So, don't trust that. Definitely it is not possible. Definitely any body can be applicable by the force by itself. By external force it is possible. We can lift. We can lift by external force. But we cannot move up by ourselves because of acceleration due to gravity. Somebody, your teacher asks question to you. Come on. What is the answer for that? No one. It is very difficult to stand up. Why? Because your entire body attracted by gravity. If you are sit down, easily you can occupy your seat. What is the reason? Because it is attracted by the earth. Like that, if the body moves up means, any body moves up, that means moves against the gravity. Against means we have to put a negative sign, that's all. So, in this equation, we have to modify that the distance can be modified by h. Height. Instead of distance, yes, we have to modify by h. What about acceleration? Here acceleration is modified as g. That's all. If it moves against the gravity, put minus. Minus g. But all others are same. So simply what happens here? V is equal to u minus gt. That is a formula. Here ut minus of gt square. Instead of a, we have to put g. Here also instead of a, I have to put g. So instead of s, we have to put h. H is equal to ut minus of at square. So forget this plus. Since it moves against the gravity, h is equal to ut minus of gt square. Similarly, v square is equal to u square minus 2gh. These are all the formula. Very clear now. So this is a thing we have to understand. The equation I have given like that. So upward or downward direction. Upward against the gravity minus, downward along the gravity plus. Then what is the maximum height reached by the body? How can you find? So I throw. The body go on, go on, go on. It cannot reach the sky. At a particular distance it covers, what happens? It returns back. What is the reason? So kindly throw a chalk. If I throw a chalk, the chalk moves upwards. That means it moves against the gravity. It cannot go beyond the certain height. Why? Because when it moves against the gravity, the velocity of the charge going on decreases. And finally, the velocity becomes zero. That is instantaneous, immediately happening. So we cannot listen to that particular position of the body. What is the reason? Immediately returns back. So it reaches the maximum height h because the velocity going on decreases. It cannot go beyond the maximum height. What is the reason? Because velocity is equal to zero. So that velocity is called final velocity. So we are throwing a chalk from the ground. That is called initial velocity. So without initial velocity, the body cannot go up. What is the reason? Because it moves against the gravity. Okay. It moves up, it attains a maximum height. Therefore, what is the formula for finding maximum height? So we know, just now we have discussed that V square is equal to U square minus 2GH. Am I correct? This is a formula just I have given the previous tab. Have you written? Very good. If what happens now? The chalk moves against the gravity, means the velocity of the chalk is going on decreases. Finally, its velocity becomes zero. Therefore, final velocity becomes zero. Therefore, U square minus 2GH. This minus 2GH comes here plus 2GH. Equal to U square or H is equal to U squared by 2G. So this is the formula. How this formula comes? These are the steps. So finally make note of the step. Why I put the zero here? Because the final velocity, it cannot go beyond the certain height. Therefore final velocity becomes zero. U square, this is the formula I have given here. This is called maximum height reached by the body. Definitely problem comes. In problem, in order to calculate the maximum height reached by the body, what are the given parameters? That velocity u, what is called u? Initial velocity. G, acceleration due to gravity. In some problem, within the bracket, they are giving g value as 10 meter per second square. If you won't give it in the particular bracket, you have to take it as 9.8. You should not put that. Okay, this is the thing. Then time to reach the maximum height. How can you find out? Time to reach the maximum height. Suppose the body travels from the ground, zero time. It gets the maximum height, velocity zero. Then it returns back. What is the time? We know V is equal to U minus AT. That means U minus GT. So just now we explained. Why I put minus? Because it moves against gravity. Why I put a G? Minus G. V is equal to. Here what happened? The final velocity becomes again? Zero. Very good. That's equal to U minus 2GT. This minus GT comes here? 2GT. That is equal to U. Therefore, T is equal to U by 2G. All here. One thing I have to remember, kindly make note of this. V is equal to U plus AT. Therefore, U minus GT, not 2GT. Somebody wrote 2. It is not 2. Because V is equal to U plus AT, first equation. Instead of A, I can put minus. So, B, kindly change this. The final velocity becomes 0. Therefore, U minus GT. Therefore, GT is equal to U or T is equal to U by G. So, this is a formula for time taken to reach the maximum height. So, can you imagine? Can you imagine yourself? So, this is easy to understand because the chalk reaches the maximum height. What is the time taken? So, suppose at 4 o'clock I throw a chalk. 4, 2, it reaches the maximum height means the time 2. The 2 seconds can be calculated by using the formula U by G. So G is a constant. If you are knowing the initial velocity, we can easily find out the time taken and also we can easily find out the maximum height. Okay, these are the two formulas with a given one parameter. If you are given U alone, we can be able to find out the value of h as well as the t. That is a different, we have to understand it. Then what is the total time taken? Suppose I throw a charge. The charge goes and reaches the maximum height. Is it there or returns to the ground? Come on. Yes, it returns to the ground. What is the time taken? It goes up t. Again, it returns to the ground also t. Two times time taken. Therefore, 2t. So, multiply by 2. 2e by g. 2u by g is called total time taken from top to ground. Are you clear? Very good. It's a, we are going to solve problems. We have to apply all these items in the particular problem. Simply substitute it. We can get the answer as far as this chapter is concerned. We need not go deep into the topic as far as this is. Directly substitution only. Because it is a simple mechanics. The mechanics means it is not any subject to physics will be not available. Or if any thermal physics or even other topic, we have to think it up in simple harmonic motion, in gravitational motion, we have to substitute. We can understand the topic. Whereas here, if you understand the formula, simply substitute it, we can get the answer. Okay. The speed with which the body return to the ground. There are three items. Kindly make note of this. One is, if the body thrown up. If the body thrown up, the first one, it reaches the maximum height. When it reaches the maximum height, the final velocity becomes zero. That is a point number one. Second one, how much height it reaches. That is also we have to find out. The third one, what is the time taken to reach the maximum height? And also, what is the total time taken? Here, the time taken to reach the ground. How can you find out this? This is the return thing. The speed with which the body returns to the ground, if your body is dropped. So, before drop, I want to discuss with you. So, this is a moving up. Suppose the body thrown down. So, then the heading can be make note of this. Thrown down. So, the body can be thrown from a height h. I take a chalk piece with my hand, the height. So, I can throw like that. I can throw. That is a one point. If it throws, what happens? It moves along the gravity. If it moves along the gravity, the acceleration becomes plus g. That's all. So, here also you have to modify that equation. So that I have not given in the slide. What is the reason? Because if you are knowing plus and minus, you can change yourself. Then only the practice will come. Therefore, the equation becomes v is equal to u plus gt. Instead of at, I can put gt. Okay, very good. What is the displacement? S is equal to, instead of s, I have to put h is equal to ut plus half gt square. Similarly, final velocity v square is equal to u squared plus 2as, instead of a, g. These are the three important formulae. If you are understanding this formula, it is easy to find the body thrown down. Now only the question asks, suppose I take a body, I keep the body at a certain height, h. If this body, simply I remove the fingers, what happened to the body? So take a chalk or any destroy, whatever may be in your hand, take to a certain height. So, if you are lifted to a second floor or third floor, you are simply seeing what happens in the ground. We can jump and come to ground. And also simply we can come to the ground. There are two things. We can force. Anybody can be forced to down or automatically it comes down. Why it automatically comes down? Because of gravity. But if the body moves up, it cannot automatically. That is the thing we have to understand. Therefore, if the body moves up means only one case, that means the upward journey. That means the body should be thrown. Then only the body moves up. Whereas, if the body comes down, there are two cases. Why? Because we may be throw the body to ground and also we can drop. What is the difference between the drop and the throw? If I throw, there must be initial velocity. Be careful. If I throw, there must be initial velocity. If I drop, drop means already the body at rest. Simply remove the finger, it comes. Therefore, it has no initial velocity. So if the body drops down, no initial velocity. That is the difference. Okay. So this is, suppose body drop. D-R-O-P, drop down. Drop down means, what happened? No initial velocity. Necessary. Then you become zero. The body moves around the gravity. What is the formula? V is equal to U plus AT. Here U becomes zero. Therefore, simply GT. Why one U comes? Because U is equal to zero. The second formula? V squared is equal to, or third one, U squared minus 2AS. Here, U squared won't come. What is the reason? Because U becomes zero. Simply 2G. And also H is equal to UT plus half AT squared. You need not put U because U is zero. Initial velocity becomes zero. Therefore, half G T squared. Therefore, in order to make height is equal to half GT squared. These are the three important formulae. Okay. So now we can see the slide now. What is the time taken to reach the ground? Time taken to reach the ground, what is the heading? Speed with which the body returns to the ground if the body is dropped from height. Dropped. Dropped means no initial velocity. Therefore, wherever U comes, you can take V itself. That is the thing. Therefore, T is equal to root of 2H by G. That is the thing time taken. How this comes? We know V squared is equal to U squared dropped down plus 2GH. Here the initial velocity is equal to 0. Therefore, V squared is equal to 2GH. Therefore, if I want to find out H means V squared by 2G. That is the thing we have to understand. Whatever the thing we have to substitute this, that's all. Everything we come in the same direction. Because here U is equal to 0. That it can be taken as V itself. Isn't it? The time taken to reach the ground. That is, this is the height. The time taken means, you know, V is equal to U squared plus 2GH or V is equal to U plus AT. Whatever may be the thing, or S is equal to UT plus half AT square. So here how can you find out? We can take how this formula come from this. S is equal to UT plus half AT square. Instead of S, I have to put the H is equal to U. Initial velocity become 0. Therefore, half instead of A plus G T square. H is equal to half g t square. From which one is t square? So keeping t square here, but 2 goes there. 2 h by g. What is t? Root of 2 h by g. So I understand how this equation comes? Because of this. This is the displacement. From this I have taken. Okay. That is the velocity with which the body reaches the ground. So this is the formula. V square is equal to 2GH or V is equal to root of 2GH. For this is the formula. For this is the formula. We have to modify it. But anyhow, if you understand the four important formula, what are they? Number one, V is equal to U plus AT. S is equal to UT plus half AT square. V square is equal to U square minus 2A or plus 2AS. SN. Distance traveled in nth second, u plus a by 2 into 2n minus 1. Simply add plus and minus, 0, everything. We can modify all the different cases. We can easily find out. Okay. This is something we have to understand. Now, this actually completes your the straight line motion. That is one dimensional motion. So, how can we understand? If you understand or not, how can I know by solving the problem only. So take this first problem, very important problem. When two bodies move towards each other with a constant speed, kindly make that problem. Two bodies move towards each other with a constant speed. The distance between them decreases at the rate of 9 meters per second. If they move in the same direction with the same speed, the distance between them increases at the rate of 4 meters per second. Find their speed. Have you understand the problem now? So, if I understand, it is easy to solve. Other it is very difficult to understand. There are two bodies, moves with a different velocity. It approaches to each other. Therefore, if it approaches to each other means the distance between the body going on decreases. Therefore, what happened here? How can you solve it? So let V1 and V2 be their velocity. Let V1, V2 be their velocities. There are two bodies move with a different velocity. Therefore, when it approaches, the velocity increases. That is relative velocity. V1 plus V2 is equal to how much? 9 meter per second. That is a given problem. 9 meter per second. When it resides, what happens? V1 minus V2. The distance between them increases at the rate of 4 meter per second, decreases at the rate of 9 meter per second. That becomes 4. So solving this equation, how can you solve? If they add, you can get 2V1 become 13. Therefore, V1 is equal to 13 by 2, 6.5. That's all. What about V2? 9 minus 6.5. That means 2.5. The individual velocity become 6.5 and 2.5. Okay. Very simple. Approaches, adding velocity, reside, velocity decreases. That is the thing we have to understand. Are you clear? So take next problem. So this is the important problem. Why I am saying this? A car covers first half a certain distance with a speed V1 and the second half distance with a speed V2. Find the average speed during the whole journey. So most of the problem in the A, B, C, D, 4 answers are given. In the A answer is given V1 plus V2 by 2, other answers are given. Immediately, as soon as if we go through the problem, V1 is the first velocity, V2 is the second velocity. What is the average velocity? Usually, how can we find the average? Add these two divided by 2, that is average. Therefore, V1 plus V2 by 2, you are simply answer A is a correct answer, it comes. That is wrong. What is physics? Yeah, be careful. So, whenever these are the thing I take, this is the whole journey. In the whole journey, this is a first half distance. Maybe I take as yes. Second half distance also taken as yes. Because we don't know what is the distance. So, that I put the first half distance is yes means. Second half distance also yes, because exactly of the value. Okay. The first half distance we cover with velocity V1. Second half distance we cover with velocity V2. Okay. So how can you solve it? What is the total distance now? Total distance yes plus yes 2s. You can ask why I put the total distance, simply we can keep it as S means, here the half distance becomes S by 2, another half to s pi, that confuses. So that I put directly s, then the total distance become 2s. Isn't it? If I want to find out what is the time taken to cover a first law distance, what is the time taken to cover a first half distance, that is t1. The general definition, velocity is equal to distance by time, therefore time is equal to distance by velocity, the first half distance s by v1, this is the time taken. Similarly, what is the time taken for second half distance? T2 is equal to s by v2. So I got the value of t1 and t2. This is the time taken. What is the total time taken? T1 plus t2. That means I take s out, 1 by v1 plus 1 by v2. This is the total time taken. So what is the average speed? The question is asked. Average speed. Simply we cannot add v1 plus v2 by 2. The average speed, how can we find out? Simply, the total distance covered by total time will give average speed. Therefore, average speed. Question is asked, average speed. The total distance, 2s. Divided by the total time, s. Into the value. 1 by v1 plus 1 by v2. That's the time taken, s into 1 by v1 plus 1 by these s's getting cancels. Therefore, 2 comes here by 2 into v1 v2 by v1 plus v2 is the answer. So, kindly make note of this. What is the answer? V2 into v1 v2 by v1 plus v2. How can it come? Very easily to find out. The value of s, the total displacement, 2s. That is s into, or you can simplify here itself, this to understand it. That is s into, for this v1 and v2, what is LCM? V1, v2 LCM, therefore v1 plus v2. S into v1 plus v2 by v1, v2, that can be, because in the denominator it is. Are you clear? 2 into v1 v2 by v1 plus v2. So this is the book work I have given here. Even it is a problem. Sometime they may be asked in the last year, kindly make note of this, the NEET examination. They are giving the v1 value is 5, v2 value is 7, calculate the average speed. Most of the students simply they are 7 plus 5, 12 divided by 2. 6 meter per second they answer it. That is wrong. What is the actual answer? 2 into 5 into 7 by 5 plus 7. So we have to simplify, that will give. This is a book work. So if the problem is asked, if anybody covers a first half distance with a certain speed, second half distance with a certain speed, therefore if velocity changes, automatically time also changes, we have to keep your mind. If time changes, so that the velocity also changes. If you are taking directly the average velocity, you are taken to consider only about velocity, you forget the time. Therefore, time also comes into picture. So that this bookwork answer, you can keep your mind. If your problem is asked, equal displacement or equal time, you have to use the formula 2 into v1 v2 by v1 plus v2. If two velocities are given, product and the addition, substitute this, automatically you can get the, okay, take it, so complete copy down. So we can try the third problem. So the problem, while solving the problem, then only what is the, is a recollection of your answer. The displacement time generated for two particles, A and B, are straight line, inclined at 60 degree and 30 degree to the time axis. Find the ratio of their speed. So that I already discussed about the graphical representation. The problem kindly take note of it. The displacement time graph for two particles, the displacement at the time graph. So kindly correction, make this correction. This displacement at the time graph RAPH. The displacement time graph for two particles A and B are straight line, inclined 60 degree and 30 degree to the time axis. Fine. Then what is the curve we all discussed out? This is a displacement time curve and automatically the angle is theta. Inclined at an angle theta. So how can he find the ratio of their speed? Speed is always slope. What is called a slope? You may understand your analytical geometry or algebraic geometry or coordinate geometry, such a method. Very, very important for your mathematical concept. We know analytical geometry. In our 11th standard, you might have studied what is the equation for a straight line. You know y is equal to mx plus c. This is called the equation for straight line. What is called y? Y is called y intercept. What is called x? X intercept. C is a constant. We least to bother about it. Here, I want to discuss what is m. M is called a slope. Then how can you find out the slope? For straight line mathematics, you may understand. The slope can be calculated by different method. The first method is first differential. Dy by dx with respect to x, we have to differentiate it, that will give the slope. As far as our problem is concerned, the another method for finding slope is, we have to find tan theta. If we are finding tan theta, that itself give the slope. Therefore, here the curve, I want to find the slope. What is the slope? Distance divided by time. Distance divided by time will give velocity or speed, so that I take the slope, tan theta we have to find out. So how can you find out tan theta here? That means find the ratio they are asking. Therefore, the speed of body A divided by speed of body B. This is called ratio. Ratio means we have to find the division. VA by VB. That is, tan theta is the slope. This tan. What about the theta? First body moves with the angle 60 degree. That is tan 60 divided by tan slope of second body. They moves with 30 degree. So we have to put the value tan 60 by tan theta. Tan 30. That will give the answer. The problem is how can you find out tan 60? So at least we should know the fundamental angles. How can you? For example, 0, 30, 45, 60, and 90, you have to keep your mind. At least you have to keep your mind. If it is in sine, you know, sine 0, 0, sine 30, half, sine 45, 1 by root 2, sine 30, root 3 by 2, sine 90, 1. So, how? Can understand for cos. First, completely reciprocal. Answer will come. You need not make it up. This 1 comes here. This root 3 by 2 comes here. Half goes there. This 1 comes here. Root 3 by 2 comes here. 1 by root 2 comes here. 1 by 2 here. 0. So this is the sine and the cos. What is tan? Sin theta by cos theta will give tan theta. Therefore, 0 by 1, 0. 1 by root 2 by root 3 by 2, 1 by root 3. Like that, we have to keep your mind. Therefore, we know that tan 60 is root 3 divided by tan 30 is 1 by root 3. That is equal to root 3 goes to the numerator. That is root 3 into root 3. The answer is simply 3. So 3 by 1. Otherwise, the ratio of the velocity between these two, that is VA by VB, equal to 3 by 1. How it comes? Because Turn 60. How can you find out turn 60? Sin 60 by cos 60. Sin 60 root 3 by 2. Isn't it? Cos 60 by, therefore 2 by 1. 2 2 getting cancelled. Therefore root 3 comes. 1 by root 3 cos or tan 30. Simply substitute, the answer becomes 3 is the answer. Correct answer is 3. Okay. We can go to next problem. Problem number 4. The displacement x of a particle moving in one atom under the action of a constant force is related to the time t by equation v is equal to root x plus 3. Find the displacement of the particle when its velocity is 0. So this is IIT problem. So IIT 39, the problem is asked. Because IIT is not worry about it. This is IIT problem, important problem also. How can you find out this? So the given item, the value of t is equal to root x plus 3. Is a value of t. Is a given. Find the displacement of the particle when its velocity is 0. The displacement the x of a particle moving in one direction. Therefore, time they are giving like that. Therefore, keeping root x here. This 3 goes there. T minus 3, root x becomes T minus 3, okay. Then squaring both sides, x become T square minus 9. T square minus. So they ask velocity. Velocity is nothing but rate of change of displacement. That is dx by dt. This is the another concept. This is the concept introduced, the latest concept we are introducing. So that in the first class itself, I derived in both the things. One is ordinary equation method. Another method is called differential calculus method. So in order to find out velocity, dx by dt we have to find out. So we have to find the first derivative of this. That is equal to t square. With respect to time, it becomes 2t. Isn't it? 2t. That's all. That is called velocity become 2t. Therefore, how can you find out? That is the thing. Find that under the action of a constant force related to the time t by equation t is equal to root x plus 3. So from it I got the value of displacement. So displacement with respect to time moving in one atom under the action of a force related to the time t by equation root of x. Find the displacement of a particle when its velocity is equal to 0. So we have to find the velocity is equal to 0. What is the time taken? That is the thing we have to understand it. Suppose if v is equal to 0, that is the condition is given. If v is equal to 0, what happened? 2t. 2t become 6. Therefore, t is equal to 3 seconds. So, from which it is clear that for squaring, that is the thing we have to understand. Sorry, 9. We have to put a 9. Why I put a 9? X is equal to 0. T square is equal to 9. From which we can take anything. Or t is equal to 3. It's a reverse problem. Whatever may be the thing. Therefore, automatically we can get t is equal to 3 seconds. How can you find out? There are two methods. Directly we can put here. X is equal to t squared minus 9. Velocity is 0. Displacement is also 0. Therefore, t squared minus 9 is equal to 0. Therefore, t squared is equal to 9. Therefore, t is equal to root of 9. Root of 9 become 3. Very clear. So, this is the way we have to solve the problems. The remaining problems, you see the next class. And also after that, we have to go to the motion in here. There is for projective motion. This is also very important. Do not confuse this problem. Very simple. T is equal to root of x plus 3. So root x is equal to t minus 3. Squaring both sides. X is equal to t square minus 9. The given problem, dx by dt. Velocity 0 means time also 0. There is displacement is also 0. Therefore, t square minus 9 is equal to 0. Therefore, t square is equal to 9. T is equal to root of 9. Root of 9 become 3. That can be find out by using this simple formula. Okay. Thank you.